promised you yesterday that we would talk about overcoming stress eating, what to do about stress eating. We talk about that today, so I wanted to give you a couple of pointers on that. I mentioned yesterday that 42% of people report that they are stress eaters, that when they are under stress, they do eat. Part of that is because, we've told you before, eating makes you feel good. It creates dopamine in your system. It helps your body feel better. And so it brings short-term pleasure, which kind of overrides the stress. Now, the first thing you can do about stress eating is eliminate the stress in your life.
Not always possible, but definitely an ideal.
Ideally, that would be the thing to do. Ideally, eliminate the stress coming in and manage the stress in a way that it doesn't involve eating, whether it's meditation or whatever, exercise,
yeah.
Whatever works for you. But so the first thing to deal with stress eating is going to be don't stress. But obviously, that's a lot easier said than done.
And I assume when they stress eat, they're not eating like plants.
No, people typically when they
good
stress
morning,
eat.
Deborah.
Hey, Deborah, that's a long. Hope you all a good morning. I'm just trying to wake up. Yes, waking up is good. Thank you for sharing. We appreciate that.
Absolutely.
So when people stress eat, they typically eat foods that are high in salt, sugar, and fat, and that's because those are the ones that give you the most dopamine. So that's going to make sense. Someone did say, I can't remember, I think maybe Valerie said yesterday, she stress eats blueberries. If you're going
to
stress eat, blueberries are a great choice.
Absolutely.
That's a phenomenal choice. Unfortunately, most people when they stress eat, they report that they feel out of control. Like they don't have any conscious say in it. What they choose to eat and how much of it they choose to eat, they feel like is completely out of control.
Mm.
And so that's a bit of a challenge. And then if you're stress eating and you feel out of control, you're dealing with guilt and shame and self-hatred and just disordered eating in general because you're not eating because you're hungry. And that leads to feeling stressed, which then leads to stress eating.
Vicious cycle.
And so you end up with this vicious cycle of shame and guilt and feeling out of control and eating. So, what can you do about that? Great, you've explained to me what's happening, Robin. That's awesome. But how do I fix it? So the first thing is to ask yourself, why? What are your triggers? What triggers you to stress eat? And it can be things like being bored. It can be self-pity. It can be to relieve anxiety. It can be, you're feeling social stress. It can be pressure from work. So there are a lot of different things that can trigger people to stress eat. And what yours are going to be individual to you. And that's a conversation to have, with a coach or with a mentor or, with someone you trust. Obviously not someone who's going to make fun of you for it. That's not the best choice.
I think we got comments coming.
Oh, I'm not paying attention to comments because I'm talking. Hey,
good morning,
Allison. Good morning.
Always good to see you.
But we've talked before about Pavlovian eating, which is that eating out of habit. The bell rings and the dog salivates. For humans, whatever your bell is, whatever that trigger is, and it causes you to eat, you've got to start to recognize that. And that means really paying attention, which is hard, because if you're stress eating and you're out of control, stopping to think is not high on the list of things that usually happens.
Mm-hmm.
So then the question is, how do you do that? What does it look like to catch yourself, even if you're just in that moment where you're stress eating and you realize, you're eating a pint of ice cream or you're eating an entire sleeve of Girl Scout cookies, that's the thing right now.
And also, I guess you have the influence of, television, right? Every time something disastrous happens on television with these variety shows, what do they do? Break out the ice cream, break out this, break out that. It's always a bad food or a bad beverage that they kind of celebrate the trauma or the stress.
Right. Laura says hormones. Yes, hormones. Cortisol is a stress hormone. And if your stress hormone is high, your body is going to say, hey, you need to eat because we have to be fueled to be able to fight or flight or do whatever we have to do to overcome this stress. So if you're dealing with chronic stress, you've probably heard humans are not designed to deal with chronic stress. We're designed to deal with acute stress, where something happens, you deal with it, and then peace comes back into your life. Unfortunately, in the current world, that's not what happens. We end up with chronic stress where every day your life is challenging.
Deborah's always
wanting
chocolate.
Chocolate is a big one.
And salt too. I've known a lot of people that have come to me and said they crave salt and they just...
And now they have chocolate with salt.
And now they have chocolate with salt. So, it's paradise, I guess.
I mean, chocolate has fat in it, so mm-hmm. your body's going to definitely crave that. It has sugar, which your body recognizes as energy. It also has antioxidants in it if you're eating dark chocolate. Mm-hmm. And so then your body's like, oh, look, I'm getting good stuff. And your conscious brain goes, yeah, not really, because it's loaded with sugar and
mm-hmm.
fat. So that's a challenge. So, all right, so we're going to ask ourselves why. We're going to think about our triggers. The second thing you're going to do once you kind of sort out what's going on is you're going to have to create a plan. So once you recognize your triggers, it doesn't do you any good to just know they happen. You have to be able to say, okay, so this trigger happens. I'm going to do something different. I'm going to break that cycle. And what does that plan look like for you? So you can decide you're going to move your body, whether it's walking or yoga or bike riding, you know, whatever that is. You can remove yourself from the space. Sometimes it's the space that's causing the stress. And no, I'm not recommending you quit your job, although I'm sure that would probably help your stress level. If you have a stressful job, quitting your job would probably help your stress level. But, you know, take a walk around the block, take a break. Take a meditation moment, take a breathing moment, whatever that looks like.
Yeah, it's kind of like see if you can find a space that is your space where you have peace. Mm-hmm. I always like to think it's the person's home, but I know that not in every case that's true.
Right,
but,
yeah.
You know, just try to find that space where it's your space and you can just, you know, zone out or whatever it is you have to do to calm yourself down or to relieve that stress.
Mm-hmm. I have clients who you know, work with me, and they sometimes they'll text me and they you know, they're on a plan where they're allowed to text me when they need support. They'll text me and they'll say, "Hey, I'm having this moment. Can you talk me through it?" Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm happy to do that. So reach out to someone, reach out to your support person or your support group, and just sometimes just talking through the stress will help you not stress eat, because you can get it out and get it out in front of your logical brain. We've talked before about how emotions, and this includes stress, get it swirling in your emotional brain, and your emotional brain has the ability to feel, but doesn't have the ability to solve. And so they end up just kind of swirling around in there, and to dampen those down, you want to eat. Well, if you can get them out by talking, and maybe it's journaling, maybe for you, you can journal or, you know, call somebody or text your coach or whatever works for you, but get those feelings out. That gives your logical brain a chance to engage with them, and then you're not going to want to damp them down with food as much, hopefully. You can distract yourself. Puzzles, coloring, those are things that we do. Reading, Russ likes to paint. We have his painting in our sunroom that he works on. So distract yourself with something else that you enjoy doing is a good thing that you can do. I mentioned journaling and writing. Also, allow the negative chemicals in your brain to subside. So stress is a negative chemical process. That's just the way stress is. And yes, it's chronic in a lot of our lives, but you have to find a way to let it subside. Because if you can let it subside, then you have a chance to feel joy. You have a chance to feel contentment, which then are not associated with wanting to cover them with dopamine and serotonin hormones that come from eating. So you have to give them a chance. Another thing we've talked before about making the unconscious conscious, observe the desire. So really look at yourself and be like, oh, right now I want chocolate. That's interesting. I wonder what that's about. And kind of talk yourself through it. I know it sounds really bizarre, but it's really a helpful thing to do. As psychologists, we recommend it for a lot of people in a lot of situations where you really observe, oh, I'm desiring that right now. That's interesting. And have the conversation with yourself about it. And of course, there's a lot of self-criticism that comes with stress. And it's self-criticism about, I shouldn't feel this way, or I should feel that way, or that. Stop shooting on yourself. Mm-hmm. That's not going to be helpful.
Everybody does, and it's very hard to, mm-hmm. sometimes very hard to overcome that. But, you know, I mean, you just have to keep pushing and trying and finding your outlet.
You know, work with the coach if you need to. And of course, the stress of yo-yo dieting and the highs and lows that come from yo-yo dieting. You know, I talk to people all the time who are trying to lose weight, and every time the scale goes up a pound, they freak out. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, you don't gain fat overnight. That's not what happens.
No. A pound one way or the other is not.
It's not life, a pound. The pound isn't a huge deal. Mm-hmm. It's the steady that makes a difference. And so dealing with that stress, and basically what I'm telling you is managing your stress is going to be your best way of dealing with stress eating. You know, people like to talk about the eating part of it. And sure, I can give you tips on how to not stress eat. But dealing with the stress and managing the stress in a productive way is going to be much more effective for you. Hey, Mark, good morning.
A bonfire.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Bonfire pits, watching the fire dance. That's a great way to relieve stress.
Yeah, get lost in the flames. Absolutely.
That's a really, really good idea. Thanks for sharing that one, Mark. So, yeah, again, your best way of dealing with stress eating is not to stress. And that means figuring out ways to deal with stress. And maybe that means, you know, getting a coach and getting some professional help. I know in our society, there's like this, I can do it myself attitude. We're very, you know, we're Americans, we can do it. Well, you know, sometimes we all need a team. And that.
And the fact of the matter is, throughout history, humans have never done it themselves.
No.
They've always done it with support and teams.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but we have
that's
that. But now in today's world, somehow we have this individuality where you have to be able to do it yourself.
And if you don't, you're considered weak somehow,
yeah.
Which
yeah.
I just, it blows my mind as a human and as a psychologist, it blows my mind that we seem to think that, that we all have to be on our own.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
Ron, I mentioned earlier that conversations are great ways. Talk it out. You know, talk to somebody you can trust, I guess, or that they would
absolutely trust. Someone you can trust.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah. But also somebody who's willing to accept that, because you're sharing stress, really.
Right.
You know, so not everybody has the ability to hear somebody else's stress and cope with it and deal with it.
And then that's something I had to learn as a psychologist, because obviously a lot of people give me a lot of their stuff and I have to figure out, okay, now I have it. What am I supposed to do with it? And that was something I had to learn as a psychologist, as someone who works in the coaching space, as someone who creates space for people to kind of unload their stuff and unpack their stuff. What do I do with it? And so I know a lot of us, not us as psychologists, but us as humans, we don't like talking to other people because we don't want to give them our stuff because we don't want them to have to deal with it. And that's why talking to someone who actually has the training to then be able to say, okay, thank you, I'm glad I could take this from you, and then realize it's not theirs, that they can just set it and say, okay, that's not mine, that's okay, we'll just hold on to that, put it over here. So I know that that's an issue that arises for people, is they don't want to bother other people.
Mm-hmm.
So that can be a challenge. So those are my notes on stress eating and stress in general. Did you have something you wanted to add? Do you have thoughts about that?
No, I mean, as I said before, just everybody needs to find what their method of releasing that stress is. And it's going to be different for everyone, right?
Mm-hmm.
As Robin said, finding somebody you can talk to or hiring somebody you can talk to is a great way to do it. I have a built-in person, so that's awesome.
Lucky you.
Yes, lucky me. But
as do I though.
Yeah. But I also use the gym.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, people will think I'm looking at them in the gym and have to try to wave to me, and I absolutely am seeing nobody because my mind is in all different directions, you know, and that's a good way for me to release stress too.
Yeah.
So,
and we bike ride.
Yeah.
So. Yep. So you have to find what works for you, but those are some tips that I can share just generally. And again, you know, if you need more help individually, I'm happy to do that. You can absolutely book a jump start with me, or, you know, if you book with me long term, then you have text access to me, so you can text me when you run into these situations.
Exactly.
So, and do that.
Oh yeah, go up the notifications when you like and share us, and make sure you select all posts. That way, you'll actually see the stuff that we post and share.
Absolutely.
Right. So that with that, we will say, eat real food,
mostly plants.
Have a great day, guys.
Have a good one. We'll see you tomorrow.